Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets. I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. In this episode, I'll tell you how to get the most out of the Qt help system. So why do you need to learn about the help system? Can't you just look it all up on Stack Overflow or ask ChatGPT? Or in other ways, well, sure you can. But you have the help at your fingertips. And sometimes it's useful to go and look at exactly what is the semantics of a specific method or what method is it that you're looking for at all. It's tempting to just rely on the completion, and with GitHub Copilot showing up in Qt Creator, it's tempting at just relying on it more or less typing your code. Sometimes it's useful to take a step back, look at the larger architecture of the classes that you use so that you can understand. I'm back in my Qt Creator now, and sure, Qt Creator is not the only IDE that exists out there. There is C Lion, there is Visual Studio Code, just to name a few, but Qt Creator is shipped together with Qt, and it's set up by default to work with Qt, and especially Qt Widgets application is super easy to do from inside of Qt Creator. So let's have a look at what it looks like. Inside here, let's imagine I want to learn something about my Qt push button. I'll place my cursor on Qt push button, and all I need to do to get help about that is press F1. Out here in the site, you can see now there is a bit of Qt push button documentation. I can look through it to see if it is what I need. But maybe I want to really study it in more detail, so I'll press F1 once more. And this time, the Qt push button documentation is full screen. When I'm done, I'll press Escape, which will make it go away again. So F1, now we have the documentation. All the documentation inside of Qt Creator is viewed using a tool that's called Qt Assistant. That is a standalone tool, but it's integrated well into Qt Creator. But if you're using one of the other IDEs where you do not have F1 at your fingertips, simply go to your shell or however you get stuff up and running and start the binary called Assistant. You can see it looks pretty much the same as what I have inside of my Qt Creator. Okay, so there's a few things to understand when you look at this. So there's the header file to include for getting my Qt push button. I'll talk more about the inclusion of header files and what options you have a bit later on, but this is at least a good start. And most often it is straightforward. If you want to go to Qt push button, you can include Qt push button. If you want to Qt label, then you'll include Qt label and so on. If I'm using QMake, I need to add this line here to be able to use it. That you'll find, for example, if you want to use a QTCP socket, then you'll need to include or add a specific line to your QMake file. You can also see the inheritance hierarchy here, and you can see that the QPush button is inherited by this class. So far, not very groundbreaking. But what you'll see down here is that you'll see a section called properties. And if you have a bit of experience with Qt already, you'll know Qt Designer, and I'll talk about that in the next module. In Qt Designer, we have this sidebar of properties, and properties is, as you know from other programming languages, it's the rather than having a getter and a setter, you can talk about a property. So a Qt push button, or let's go to the Qt abstract push button, it has way more. It, for example, has a text property, which is whether the text is, well, what the text is on that Qt push button. And you can see the type is a QString. It has an icon, which has the type QIcon and so on. And most often, when you just want to learn about stuff, you'll go and look at the properties section. Oh, of course, it's called text. I don't know what you could have come up with otherwise. And then you know that there are two methods, one for reading it, which is just called text as a property, and one for setting it, which is called set text with T capitalized. And if I click here on text, we can see that is exactly the two methods that we have here. There is the possibility of integrating other systems, and the most useful one of those is the C++ reference documentation. And up here is a link to a Qt Widgets and More episode I recorded where I'm integrating the documentation for C++, as you can see here, into Qt Creator. That's useful whenever you just want to look up something. And of course, my interest is often in the algorithms. So here is the algorithms library that comes with Qt, that comes with C++. That's basically what you need to know about Qt Assistant integration. Two more things that I'd like to mention, though, is first of all, down here at the very bottom, you can see the locator. And to get to that, you press Control K. And if you have a piece of paper, now it's a good time to write Control K until that is in your fingers. And that is how you navigate around your source code without needing to go and file open or find it in the sidebar. This example here is pretty trivial because I only had two files, but in general. And when you press Control K, press question mark, and if you want to know about, say, QTCP, spell great, QTCP socket, as I was referring to before, then question mark QTCP socket, and it offers me a few different versions here. I can set that up in the settings for Qt Creator, which one should be used. Let's go and look at Qt 6.5, and now you can see that for that, I need Qt plus equal to network. Another useful thing when you're sitting in here and you are looking at stuff is that you can press F2 to follow the symbol underneath the cursor. And often you'll do that navigating your own source code. But for Qt classes, you can get to the header files too. And so if I have a Qt push button here, or I have the show method here, I can press F2. Did not work out that well for the show method. For the Qt push button, it definitely does. Not why does it not do that? Let's have a small break while I try and figure that out. There is nothing more frustrating than sitting with a black box that just doesn't work. But fortunately, Qt comes with a source code. It can be difficult to navigate, but at codebrowser.dev, KDAB has a browser for the Qt source code. And not just the Qt source code, also Boost, the Linux kernel, KDE, and many more. A link on the screen right now. Hey, that was funny. And that's what's so great about classes. I could have re-recorded this error that I had here, the part of the video, but I will not do that in this series. Whenever I hit something, I'll take a break and we'll have a learning experience from it together. So in the previous episode, I showed you how I could run qmake minus project. And let me just show you what that project file looked like. It looks like this. And that's where you go, yes, but didn't you just say that you need to write Qt plus equal to widgets? Yes, in Qt 6 I do. And obviously qmake minus project here picked up and generated me a Qt 5 version. So it did not do that. So let me just restore my X Hello World. Come on, xhelloworld.pro, and go back in here, and now, yes, I want to. This is the file that I have here. When I go into my main.cpp, and I wait just a wee little, it'll go away up there, or I can build it, now it'll go away. And then when I press F2 on show, there we are. So now you can see I'm in qwidget.h, so show, it's not coming from qbutton, it comes from qwidget. Else, left arrow, well, says here, to go back. And if I press on Q push button, you can see the Q push button here is subclassing from Q abstract button. Q abstract button is subclassing from Q widget. So that small detour here showed me, no pun intended, that show comes from Q widget superclass. And if I want to learn more about Q push button, sometimes it's just easier to just go over here and read what it does rather than read the whole documentation. It is possible and not that complex, but that's for another time. to set up so you actually can get into the source code of Qt itself. That source code is shipped in the SDK, but separately from the rest of it. That's it for this episode. I hope that you enjoyed it. In the next episode, we'll start looking at the Qt's object model. So stay tuned, and until next time, have a great time.